is really a miracle and a celebration of so much. And just as today in convocation, we celebrated the accomplishments in academic fronts and our individual faculty members and urged everyone to be more effective messengers and ambassadors about all the good that's going on at Webster. This event gives us a rather formal way to make what is outstanding in teaching and learning and academics at Webster University. So, over the past decade or so, we've moved it all around St. Louis to different locations. We've had different surprise speakers. So, for those of you who are with us for the first time tonight, the long tradition is that you don't know until, in this case, Julian introduces the person who is the designated speaker. And we have had a variety of people over the years. I think there are some people in the audience tonight who actually have served that function before. And if you have, will you raise a hand? And the trick for Julian is a bit of a complement to what we try to do at convocation, which is to imagine what the message, what the theme, what the focus needs to be throughout the year in advance. And so you know today that we have called the event for students to come back to. And so we thought, why would we go anywhere else? We're coming back home. And we're going to do the comeback tour here in our own facility. So that's why we're here. And of course, a year ago, we thought the right message was comeback. So it was a departure from the way we usually do for speaker, in that we actually had two speakers, Scott Johnson and Jody Spies, and they did it virtually for us. When you see them, out and about this year, give them a thank you, because we never get to really celebrate them in person the way we're going to get to do tonight. So I'm going to hand this over to Julian to introduce our selected speaker tonight, and I hope that the choice we have made delights you as much as I anticipate that it will, and that it gives us yet another reason to be very happy to be at Webster University. So welcome and thank you.
Thank you, Beth. Again, it gives me a great pleasure to be here. I do not like to give two speeches in the same day, especially when everybody, when a lot of people tell me that I will be speak very well. That means to know that it can go only down. I hope not. I made some notes about the speaker, but I would also like to spend a few minutes to again thank you for being here. This nothing makes me genuinely happier. But to see your dedication to Webster University and, most importantly, to each other and to our students. We can agree or disagree on the infinite number of matters, but when we all agree is that our students and our university comes first. In the beginning of my career, I used to say it's okay to clap. I guess now I know that I passed that test. So, again, today is both symbolically and, if you wish, formatively a big day for Webster University. We are coming back together. Not that we ever departed, but we are coming back together to see each other, to shake hands, to look each other in the eye, and yes, I hope those masks will come down soon. I again thank you for your dedication I would say bravely, but education to be here and to support each other. Today's speaker, and it's my great privilege to introduce our speaker tonight. So I'll ask that person a couple of minutes ago, what would she suggest or he suggest to a meet? And there was nothing to admit. So whatever I do, I will not do that person a favor. And I will say a few information about the individual. You know that individual, some of you very well, some of you a little bit. But here's what I would like to start, and I hope I'm going to finish with that. This is the individual you want to meet. This is the individual you want to listen. This is the individual you want to talk to. And then to remember everything in that order. That individual, prior to coming to the Webster University, studied at Michigan State University. And I will start to reveal a little bit more and more. He studied music, and he received the Excellence in Teaching citation from the Michigan State University, which is a university-wide recognition and award to individuals, graduate students, who teach undergraduate classes, or for an impact on undergraduate classes. The doctoral dissertation dealt with the songwriting, practice of songwriting, songwriters. It had an ethnographic, very, as you can imagine, you know, for a big point to anybody who appreciates ethnography, ethnographic or songwriters in the master chemistry. So, excellence in teaching. And then, our speaker regularly publishes in the several journals. I have written the names of the journals, and what happened is, I had this piece of paper, and I had whatever I was drinking, you know, left. So, but those are reputable journals, general. Now I sound like my son, I can tell you, you know, when I ask him, you know, when he was a little kid, I asked him, you know, okay, tell us why Roman Empire collapsed. And he looked at me when he was 6 years old, and he said, because they have a lot of problems. So obviously I have a son, not a lot, you know. But it has to do with the philosophy of music education, it has to do with the music research education, and so on and so forth. But the bottom line here is not the names of the journal. The bottom line is excellence in the teaching and excellence in the scholarship. So, colleagues, friends, please join me in welcome Dr. Stuart Chapman Hill.
Well, that sounds like it's fine. I seem to be hearing it this time. I can hear myself maybe more clearly than I would have been. It is such a tremendous honor to be with you this evening. It is such a tremendous honor to get to address you. If you're ever nervous before something you do, let me encourage you to have Julian Fuster introduce you, because it will make you laugh. And it will make you move, and I'll make you forget me of your days. So thank you. That was very gracious, and it's much appreciated. Before I get into talking with you about Rainer and the heterophonic idea, whatever the hell that might be, I actually want to pose a question to you. So this is an immediate audience participation. If you have a smartphone handy, if you grab that, you're going to go to menti.com and enter the code 315-9233, or if your phone can see that QR code, you can scan it and go right there. This is very informative. It looks like you really didn't want to miss a moment of my speech. So scanning the QR code. That's good. So, menti.com, 315-9233, or scan the QR code, assist your neighbors as needed or wanted. It's still up there. Yes, very good. You're already participating. This is exciting. So if you miss the code, it's up here. I want to ask you what music is for. And I really want to ask about what its function is. And we're getting a lot of answers up here. This is great. You know, when I practiced this on my own, nobody responded. So this is really exciting. So I'm just going to highlight some of the things I see here. We have community building. We have to express the human experience. I love that. To change attitudes and emotions. I love that as well. I'm seeing a lot of answers that somehow relate to the idea of emotion, which of course is central. And I also really like this word transport. That's really good. Making burlaps get weird. Well, how much help do they need? Emotional engagement, expressing emotions, long drives and short drives, remembering high school. That's really nice. We have just about 12 more seconds till it's going to close. These are even better than I imagined them being. For dancing like no one is watching, that's really good. Bond with human experience today. Okay, voting's closed. It's time limited. I'm sorry. But you can continue to discuss that with each other as the evening goes on. I want to talk to you a little bit about what I think music is for based on some scholars I really admire. Not least among them, the late musicologist named Christopher Snow, who would say that I actually asked you a trick question. He would say there's no such thing as what music is for because there's no such thing as music. I'm very sorry to inform you. There's no such thing as music, which makes me wonder what my job is for. But nevertheless, Christopher Snow would say music is not a thing but an activity. It's a thing that people do. It's a dynamic social interaction that happens. And when we refer to music as a thing, we classify it in a way that is not natural. It is a process that happens in many individuals, and the thingness of it is a figment that disappears as soon as it's gone. And so instead, Christopher Snow preferred that we think of the word music as a verb, as in music king, the title of his book, or to music, which is to take part in any capacity in a musical performance. That includes performing, listening, rehearsing, practicing, composing, dancing, as some of you mentioned in the survey. He actually goes on to say that we might as well include the person taking tickets at the door. We might as well include the person, the lady who sets up the speaker on the side of the stage, because all of them are engaged in, that is the role I want information from, thank you. Yes, okay, good. because all of those people are involved in the dynamic social activity that makes music what it is. And the reason for that is because those dynamic social interactions create relationships in that space and in that time. And sometimes those relationships are ideal relationships, as we imagine them, between person and person, individual and society, humanity and the natural world, perhaps even the supernatural world. A similar sentiment is offered by Thomas Torino, who's an ethnomusicologist, and he says that it's not really accurate to say that art is an imitation of life, but rather that artistic processes crystallize the very essence of a good life by dramatically emphasizing the interplay of future possibilities with experiences and things we already know from the past. It is because I was going to read that many words that I only had one deal before the speech, because I knew I was going to stumble if I didn't. But basically, what both Torino and Snow are saying is that music is part of our social imagination. It is part of how we imagine the way in which the world could be, not only how it is right now. So what does that sound like in practice? Well, let's listen to a little CISO tape. Quite a world that is. So there may be some jazz. There also may be some that it doesn't sound like your favorite Benny Goodman or Duke Ellington tune. And it's a little less predictable, it's a little looser, it's a little more timid. Cecil Taylor was a leader in the free jazz movement, and so the idea was to break jazz free of things like pop chord progressions and style structures, and instead to truly let it be free in the moment, to come from the artist's souls in that time and in that place without much preconception. Another scholar who writes about this and about race sound and poetry and production, Anthony Lee, says that if you're really going to grasp free improvisation, you have to feel how it is, has these implicit investments in embodiment and how it outlines an alternative grounding conception of sociality, such that it makes thinkable other ways of being and being together. In other words, that liberatory practice of jazz improvisation, of free jazz improvisation, is not solely for the musicians in the room. It's about imagining another world between human beings. Here's another way of something to listen to. This will get your head back in. And if it doesn't, you're broken. You'll see your back. This is by the famous band E.T. Manset and the Templars, who are from the great nation of Ghana. And this is some high life music. High life was a very important musical genre in the 20th century in Ghana. Some of you may know that I just got back from Ghana. I was there earlier in the summer. Yes! It was awesome. And I would love to talk to you about it more. On the way to being there and while being there, and since I've been thinking a lot about high life music, because high life is this form of popular music that you can maybe feel some of the Western influences. You can maybe feel the influence of big band jazz. You can maybe feel a little bit of calypso. But there's also this effort over and over again in Ghana to re-indigenize it, to re-infuse it with what is native to that environment and to that world. And that was really important over the course of the 20th century as the former colony of the Gold Coast became the independent nation of Ghana. And this music was literally part of imagining a new urban lifestyle for Ghanaian people who were moving out of villages and into big cities, becoming wage laborers, doing things that they had not done before. And so it wasn't just about building a steam at the end of a long week. In the process of that musicing, and remember that includes the performers, the patrons, the bar owner, the bartender, everybody. They were literally defining a new nation for themselves. So what I'm saying is that musicking is an activity and a practice rather than a thing. I'm saying that it is a way of modeling human relationships. And I'm saying, I haven't said this explicitly yet, but I should, but this doesn't require actually the function of the words or the lyrics. It's implicit in the socialist or in the structure of the music itself. So that is my theoretical framework. If you are reviewer number two, I hope that you are happy with my theoretical framework, because I'm now going to proceed with the rest of my paper. Speaking of implicit structure, I want to talk about a very important dimension of structure in music, which is texture, which can mean a lot of different things. But for my purposes, I want to talk about the way in which individual parts or voices are put together in a piece of music. And there are some kind of classical terms that we would teach you in music appreciation or music history, or music theory, about texture. and they have Manasseh, Manasseh, and Philistine. Right? This is so exciting. Maybe this is the view for you, but or maybe it's brand new to you. Either way, I'm going to delight in being your music teacher for a moment, because I was a middle school music teacher once upon a time, and it was so much fun. So, monotony, as you can maybe infer from the prefix, means kind of a single voice or a single sound. When I say voice, I don't mean a human person. I mean a melodic one. There could be 50 people singing, but it's one melodic voice happening. And kind of the classic example of this is Gregorian chant. Take a listen. Seems like you can hear there are multiple people singing, but they are in utter lockstep with each other. Perhaps for liturgical doctrinal reasons that we can imagine, right? So that unison is really kind of an important feature of that music. Contrast that with homophony. This is what homophony sounds like. Art Chapel's the Webster University Chamber Singers, yeah, singing the Webster University alma mater, yeah. So you can hear maybe, and it helps that there are lyrics, you can hear that they're still moving in lockstep, lockstep, I don't know what lockstep is, lockstep, together, but they're singing different pitches. So whereas the monks are singing early exact same melody, now we have a soprano part, an alto part, a tenor part, a bass part, each of their own pitch profile, but they're still moving together, still singing those same words at the same time. Polyphony, on the other hand, many verses, and there are much more underpinnings. And you're going to feel this in the fugue that we listen to, but you're also going to see it, because there are all these great visualization animations on YouTube of fugues. Paula Tilati Fierce is nodding her head. So you're going to see the different voices go down. This is a four verse field, and it starts with what I'm sure Bach thought of as the beginning verse. Here comes a different voice. And third voice. I don't want to think of that green verse only like a hugely high score on whatever game is being played, right? Oh, locking up the points. Yeah, absolutely. So you can hear the independence in those verses. You can maybe even see it in the still image here. There's other kinds of stuff going on. Those verses do not have to be in lockstep with each other. They do have to complement each other, but they don't have to be in lockstep with each other. Okay, monophony, homophony, polyphony, that's my class course. Texas is test, right? It is not sleep. Listen to this instead, then, and see if you can determine which of those it is.
Mm-hmm.
think I might be tempted to call that monotony because they're singing kind of the same melody, but maybe you also can feel the kind of in there. There's a lot of what I would call melodic drift. There's a lot of space, a lot of time taken by each individual singer that are moving in and out together. But they're also clearly not in the same kind of rhythm that those notes chanting together are in the same way. Yes, you're not in your heads. This is good. So this is a practice called lining out. It goes back several centuries. It was very important in certain early American, especially Baptist congregations. Wherein there were too few worshippers who could read the signs or the text in the given books because they couldn't read. They couldn't afford the books in the first place. Nor could they read music, so they couldn't have sung tunes had they been printed, but they actually largely weren't. It was usually just the lyrics. So instead, there needed to be a leader, who, by the way, may or may not have read music, but at least knew the texts and knew the coming tunes. And who could, as you saw happening in that video, intune a line of his own, then everybody sings it back to him, then he could intune the next one, they sang it back. And as you can hear, it gave birth to a singing style in which the tunes were freely elaborated. So it's, when I say that there's melodic drift, I'm actually not making a value judgment on it. What's happening is that those singers are feeling like they can take their time feeling them, that they can add a note to it right there, because in the response to the poem, it's their response to note. They can really make something of their own out of it and freely elaborate. That is not monotony, polyphony, or homophony. It's heterophony. Everybody say heterophony. That's good. Thank you. You can take the teacher out of the middle school, but not the middle school out of the teacher. So, simultaneous variation, accidental or deliberate, of what is identified as the same melody. I almost think of this like a best fit line on static rock, right? So the best fit line is sort of the average melody that's being sung, but there are all these individual variations. That's the idea. Here's another bit of heterophony that I just, I love. And if you don't love it, that's okay, but you're broken, so you're back there. Listen to that all day long. And you can hear that one voice who doesn't care if he's anywhere near the melody. I love that guy. That's my favorite guy. Right. So, like so many important American genres, there's just to be explicit about it, there's a white version and there's a black version. And I like the black version better. What you can hear in there is, I think, an even more flawed bit of heterophony. There's an even more expression happening in the individual responses. Interestingly, this was sort of a subversive move on the part of some black congregations because other worship styles were prohibited by black and white clergy alike. But lining out, because it was sort of European in origin, was okay. And so it was a ride. But, as so often happens, they took it and they made it their own. They put on the sufficiently European mask and then they made all that they needed it to be. This is the source of, in my opinion, a great deal of beauty. And once again, you can hear that looseness that's in there. Where each, this is my favorite sentence, I might get this as a tattoo later. Each individual finds their place of vocal comfort in a variegated hierarchy. I love that so much. And what William T. Darden, who is a scholar of this music, points out is that this really highlights what he identifies as the functional nature of black performance in which singing is judged good or not so good based on what it does, rather than necessarily how it sounds to a certain kind of aesthetic feel. And why that's important is because actually, in some ways, us watching that is utterly artificial. There is no audience for that performance, right? Other than the people in the room, because it happens that there was a camera that time. Everyone in that room is a participant or a potential participant, as Thomas Chandler would say. So it's really about how it sounds to some audience. It's about what it does for the community of people musically in that room together. So, I want to make clear that I'm not trying to make a Baptist of you or me, just so you're really clear. Although if you are, congratulations, I think that's great. What I want to draw out is what that form of musicing says to me, just as a person living in this world. I noticed, for example, that illiteracy was not allowed to be a barrier to participation, but rather that the form grew in such a way that all were enabled and arguably empowered to participate. I noticed that it has my favorite sonnets in the world. Each individual finds their place of vocal comfort in a very good direction. I noticed that no emotions of clarity don't get in the way of what is the true function of the song. And this is maybe my favorite thing about it. The tune and text are common. It's not musical anarchy. It is a common tune and a common text, but there is room and even welcome for individual variation. So if you ask me to go back to the question at the beginning about music in the story, it's so that each individual can find their place in the very way of that. It's so we can, you can fight for that. For the record, you can fight for anything I say. You just go all ahead. And so what I want to imagine, this is maybe the part of the talk where I pivot to sort of TED Talk style, broad extrapolation from a rather narrow set of scholarship, if that's what we do. But I have to remember what life would be like in a heterophonic world. And I don't mean that only musically. What if we actively pursued forms whose focus was access and differentiation? What if we actively pursued common tasks that allowed seats of an individual with them? What if we didn't let narrow preconceived notions of clarity matter nearly as much as being a participant and engaged and having a functional relationship with things? I think sometimes people think that trained musicians like me are snobs. We actually just want people to sing. We actually just want people to music. That's what I want for the world. And I think in a world that valued harassment to get back to the particular musical consequences of this, I think there'd be a ton more singing because we would be liberated by that space for individual variation, liberated by that notion that each voice finds their place in the variable of harassment. I think there should be more singing because I love singing, and those of us who are engaged regularly in singing know how valuable it is. In fact, in the last 18 months, we figured out how to host choirs on Zoom. We figured out how to make virtual choirs to post on YouTube. We've taken the things that happen in rehearsal halls outside to patios where it's hot and we're all wearing masks. Because we know how absolutely essential it is for that music to take place. And we know that because we were engaged in it before. But my suspicion is that at least one of you, something about those videos made me preachy. There's at least one of you here. Turn to your neighbor and say, no, but I'm kidding. Slow down, Stuart. There's at least one of you, and probably several, who were told in childhood that you couldn't sing. Yes. Or maybe you were gently told to mouth the words. On behalf of music teachers everywhere, I want to say I'm sorry that happened to you. Because in a heterophonic world, it never will. Because your voice would have found its place in that very world of heterophonic. So perhaps we should come to the conclusion that you're anticipating or even dreading. We are going to sing. And you are going to find your place of vocal comfort in the variegated heterophony. I want to observe that I personally find the idea of an alma mater, a school song, is so lovely to me. But it is it is also kind of a strange thing when it's a school not necessarily that you intended, but you're employed by. Like I think of alma maters as being for students in a room now. That is the kind of brand that alma maters tend to express. But why should it be this? This is the comeback to you. We are here together in this space. And so we're going to sing the rest of our alma mater together. I don't know who put this piano here, but that was very nice of them. So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to profane the tradition of alma mater by approximating it, but I'm going to just demonstrate it line by line. So I'll sing the menu song. Good. Are you in the choir? Okay, fine. Let it strike and cloud and wisdom to impart your tongue. Let it strike and cloud and wisdom to impart. We are sad of the magic community to your tongue. We are flying by the diverse community. What's the room you are? What's the room you are? Good. So yay! Oh, I see. You think we're finished. That's cute. We're not. So I'm going to sing the whole melody. You listen back and review because you're getting ready to stand and sing it. So it sounds like this. Just listen to the whole thing one more time. We heard you do and close to our heart. With strength and pride and wisdom to impart. We are found loving by my diverse community.
A delightful, hardly captured state. Spectacular, amazing, invigorating. Thank you, Spirit, for what you've done for us tonight. And what a good message for us to go through the year. You sound damn good. Thank you, and I let Julian close us out, and let this be the first day of many wonderful days where we just feel the rest within the world.
Thank you, Beth. I don't have anything to say because I think that's still absolutely said and saying everything that we need to do. As somebody who was scared of the fourth grade, that I sound like a bear. Still, personally, thank you for estar sendo em comunhão. Davi revelou. Revelou continue to sing the Webster song, because that is us. Thank you, Stuart, for bringing us back together.